The Crusade of the Excelsior. By Bret Harte. Podcast 8 of 9. Part 2. Freed. Chapter 6. A more important arrival. The commander was the first to recover his presence of mind. Taking the dispatch from the hands of the unlooked-for husband of the woman he loved, he opened it with an immovable face and habitual precision. Then, turning with a military salute to the strangers, he bade them join him in half an hour at the Presidio, and, bowing gravely to the assembled company, stepped from the corridor. But Mrs. Markham was before him, stopped him with a gesture, and turned to her husband. "James Markham, where's your hand?" Markham, embarrassed but subjugated, disengaged it timidly from his wife's waist. "Give it to that gentleman, for a gentleman he is, from the crown of his head to the solace of his boots. There. Shake his hand. You don't get such a chance every day. You can thank him again, later." As the two men's hands parted, after this perfunctory grasp, and the commander passed on, she turned again to her husband. "Now, James, I am ready to hear all about it. Perhaps you'll tell me where you have been." There was a moment of embarrassing silence. The doctor and secretary had discreetly withdrawn, the alcalde, after a brief introduction to Mr. Brimmer, and an incomprehensible glance from the wife, had retired with a colorless face. Donna Isabel had lingered last to blow a kiss across her fan to Eleanor Keane that half mischievously included her brother. The Americans were alone. Thus appealed to, Mr. Markham hastily began his story. But, as he progressed, a slight incoherency was noticeable. He occasionally contradicted himself, and was obliged to be sustained, supplemented, and, at times, corrected, by Keane and Brimmer. Substantially, it appeared that they had come from San Francisco to Mazatlan, and, through the influence of Mr. Brimmer on the Mexican authorities, their party, with an escort of dragoons, had been transported across the Gulf and landed on the opposite shore, where they had made a forced march across the desert to Todos Santos. Literally interpreted, however, by the nervous Markham, it would seem that they had conceived this expedition long ago, and yet had difficulties because they only thought of it the day before the steamer sailed, that they had embarked for the Isthmus of Nicaragua, and yet had stopped at Mazatlan, that their information was complete in San Francisco, and only picked up at Mazatlan, that friends sometimes contradictorily known as he and she had overpowering influence with the Mexican government, and alone had helped them, and yet that they were utterly dependent upon the efforts of Senor Perkins, who had compromised matters with the Mexican government and everybody. "Do you mean to say, James Markham, that you've seen Perkins, and it was he who told you we were here?"
"No, not him exactly. Let me explain," said Mr. Brimmer hastily. "It appears," he corrected his haste with practical business-like precision, "that the filibuster Perkins, after debarking you here, and taking the Excelsior to Kinkinambo, actually established the Kinkinambo government, and got Mexico and the other confederacies to recognize its independence. Kinkinambo behaved very handsomely, and not only allowed the Mexican government indemnity for breaking the neutrality of Todos Santos by the seizure, but even compromised with our own government their claim to confiscate the Excelsior for treaty violation, and paid half the value of the vessel, besides giving information to Mexico and Washington of your whereabouts. We consequently represent a joint commission from both countries to settle the matter and arrange for your return. But what I want to know is this: is it to Senor Perkins that we ought to be thankful for seeing you here at all?" asked Mrs. Markham impatiently.
"No, no, not that, exactly," stammered Markham.
"Oh, come now, Susanna."
"No," said Richard Keane earnestly, "by Jove, some thanks ought to go to Bell Montgomery." He checked himself in sudden consternation. There was a chilly silence. Even Miss Keane looked anxiously at her brother, as the voice of Mrs. Brimmer for the first time broke the silence.
"May we be permitted to know who is this person to whom we owe so great an obligation?"
"Certainly," said Brimmer, "she was, as I have already intimated, a friend, possibly, you know," he added, turning lightly to his companions, as if to corroborate an impression that had just struck him, perhaps A.A. a sweetheart of the Seigneur Perkins. "And how was she so interested in us, pray?" said Mrs. Markham.
"Well, you see, she had an idea that a former husband was on board of the Excelsior."
He stopped suddenly, remembering from the astonished faces of Keane and Markham that the secret was not known to them, while they, impressed with the belief that the story was a sudden invention of Brimmer's, with difficulty preserved their composure. But the women were quick to notice their confusion, and promptly disbelieved Brimmer's explanation.
"Well, as there's no Mr. Montgomery here, she's probably mistaken," said Mrs. Markham, with decision, "though it strikes me that she's very likely had the same delusion on board of some other ship. Come along, James, perhaps after you've had a bath and some clean clothes, you may come out a little more like the man I once knew. I don't know how Mrs. Brimmer feels, but I feel more as if I required to be introduced to you than your friend's friend, Mrs. Montgomery. At any rate, try and look and behave a little more decent when you go over to the Presidio." With these words she dragged him away. Mr. Brimmer, after a futile attempt to appear at his ease, promptly effected the usual marital diversion of carrying the war into the enemy's camp. "For heaven's sake, Barbara," he said, with ostentatious indignation, "go and dress yourself properly. Had you neither money nor credit to purchase clothes? I declare I didn't know you at first, and when I did, I was shocked, before Mrs. Markham, too.
Mrs. Markham, I fear, has quite enough to occupy her now," said Mrs. Brimmer shortly, as she turned away, with hysterically moist eyes, leaving her husband to follow her. Oblivious of this comedy, Richard Keane and Eleanor had already wandered back, hand in hand, to their days of childhood. But even in the joy that filled the young girl's heart in the presence of her only kinsman, there was a strange reservation. The meeting that she had looked forward to with eager longing had brought all she expected. More than that, it seemed to have been providentially anticipated at the moment of her greatest need, and yet it was incomplete. She was ashamed that after the first recognition, a wild desire to run to Hurlstone and tell him her happiness was her only thought. She was shocked that the bright joyous face of this handsome lovable boy could not shut out the melancholy austere features of Hurlstone, which seemed to rise reproachfully between them. When, for the third and fourth time, they had recounted their past history, exchanged their confidences and feelings, Dick, passing his arm around his sister's waist, looked down smilingly in her eyes. "And so, after all, little Nell, everybody has been good to you, and you have been happy. Everybody has been kind to me, Dick, far kinder than I deserved. Even if I had really been the great lady that little Donna Isabel thought I was, or the important person the commander believed me to be, I couldn't have been treated more kindly. I have met with nothing but respect and attention. I have been very happy, Dick, very happy." And with a little cry she threw herself on her brother's neck and burst into a childlike flood of inconsistent tears. Meantime the news of the arrival of the relief party had penetrated even the peaceful cloisters of the mission, and Father Esteban had been summoned in haste to the council. He returned with an eager face to Hurlstone, who had been anxiously awaiting him. When the padre had imparted the full particulars of the event to his companion, he added gravely, "You see, my son, how Providence, which has protected you since you first claimed the church's sanctuary, has again interfered to spare me the sacrifice of using the power of the church in purely mundane passions. I weakly accept the rebuke of his better ordained ways, and you, Diego, may comfort yourself that this girl is restored directly to her brother's care, without any deviousness of plan or human responsibility." "You do not speak, my son," continued the priest anxiously, "can it be possible that, in the face of this gracious approval of Providence to your resolution, you are regretting it?" The young man replied, with a half-reproachful gesture, "Do you, then, think me still so weak?" "No, Father Esteban, I have steeled myself against my selfishness for her sake. I could have resigned her to the escape you had planned, believing her happier for it, and ignorant of the real condition of the man she had learned to pity. But, he added, turning suddenly and almost rudely upon the priest, do you know the meaning of this eruption of the outer world to me? Do you reflect that these men probably know my miserable story, that, as one of the passengers of the Excelsior, they will be obliged to seek me and to restore me, he added, with a bitter laugh, to my home, my kindred, to the world I loathe. But you need not follow them. Remain here. Here, with the door thrown open to any tale-bearer or perhaps to my wife herself. Never. Hear me, father, he went on hurriedly, these men have come from San Francisco, have been to Mazatlan. Can you believe that it is possible that they have never heard of this woman's search for me? No. The quest of hate is as strong as the quest of love, and more merciless to the hunted. But if that were so, foolish boy, she would have accompanied them. You are wrong. It would have been enough for her to have sent my exposure by them to have driven me from this refuge. This is but futile fancy, Diego, said Father Esteban, with a simulated assurance he was far from feeling. Nothing has yet been said, nothing may be said. Wait, my child. Wait, he echoed bitterly. Wait until the poor girl shall hear perhaps from her brother's lips the story of my marriage as bandied about by others, wait for her to know that the man who would have made her love him was another's, and unworthy of her respect? No. It is I who must leave this place, and at once. You, echoed the padre. How? By the same means you would have used for her departure. I must take her place in that ship you are expecting. You will give me letters to your friends. Perhaps, when this is over, I may return if I still live. Padre Esteban became thoughtful. You will not refuse me, said the young man, taking the padre's hand. It is for the best, believe me. I will remain secret here until then. You will invent some excuse, illness, or what you like, to keep them from penetrating here. Above all, to spare me from the misery of ever reading my secret in her face. Father Esteban remained still absorbed in thought. You will take a letter from me to the Archbishop, and put yourself under his care, he asked at last, after a long pause. You will promise me that? I do. Then we shall see what can be done. They talk, those Americanos, continued the priest, of making their way up the coast to Punta San Iago, where the ship they have already sent for to take them away can approach the shore, and the commandante has orders to furnish them escort and transport to that point. It is a foolish indiscretion of the government, and I warrant without the sanction of the church. Already there is curiosity, discontent, and wild talk among the people. Ah! Thou sayest truly, my son, said the old man, gloomily, the doors of Todos Santos are open. The commandante will speed these heretics quickly on their way, but the doors by which they came and whence they go will never close again. But God's will be done. And if the open doors bring thee back, my son, I shall not question his will. It would seem, however, as if Hurlstone's fears had been groundless. For in the excitement of the succeeding days, and the mingling of the party from San Antonio with the newcomers, the recluse had been forgotten. So habitual, had been his isolation from the others, that, except for the words of praise and gratitude hesitatingly dropped by Miss Keene to her brother, his name was not mentioned, and it might have been possible for the relieving party to have left him behind unnoticed. Mr. Brimmer, for domestic reasons, was quite willing to allow the episode of Miss Montgomery's connection with their expedition to drop for the present. Her name was only recalled once by Miss Keene. When Dick had professed a sudden and violent admiration for the coquettish Dona Isabel, Eleanor had looked up in her brother's face with a half-troubled air. Who was this queer Montgomery woman, Dick? She said. Dick laughed a frank, reassuring, heart-free laugh. Perfectly stunning, Nell. Such a figure in tights? You ought to have seen her dance my... Hush. I dare say she was horrid. Not at all. She wasn't such a bad fellow, if you left out her poetry and gush, which I didn't go in for much though the other fellows he stopped, from a sudden sense of loyalty to Brimmer and Markham. No, you see, Nell, she was regularly ridiculously struck after that man Perkins whom she'd never seen a kind of schoolgirl worship for a pirate. You know how you women go in for those fellows with a mystery about M. No, I don't, said Miss Keene sharply, with a slight rise of color, and I don't see what that's got to do with you and her. Everything. She was in correspondence with Perkins, and knows about the Excelsior affair, and wants to help him get out of it with clean hands, don't you see? That's why she made up to us. There, Nell, she ain't your style, of course, but you owe a heap to her for giving us points as to where you were. But that's all over now, she left us at Mazatlan, and went on to Nicaragua to meet Perkins somewhere there, for the fellow has always got some Central American revolution on hand, it appears. Until they garrote or shoot him someday, he'll go on in the liberating business forever. Then there wasn't any Mr. Montgomery, of course, said Eleanor. Oh, Mr. Montgomery, said Dick, hesitating. Well, you see, Nell, I think that, knowing how correct and all that sort of thing Brimmer is, she sort of invented the husband to make her interest look more proper. It's shameful, said Miss Keene indignantly. Come, Nell, one would think you had a personal dislike to her. Let her go, she won't trouble you nor, I reckon, anybody, much longer. What do you mean, Dick? I mean she has regularly exhausted and burned herself out with her hysterics and excitements, and the drugs she's taken to subdue them, to say nothing of the Panama fever she got last spring. If she don't go regularly crazy at last she'll have another attack of fever, hanging round the isthmus waiting for Perkins. Meanwhile, undisturbed by excitement or intrusion of the outer world, the days had passed quietly at the mission. But one evening, at twilight, a swift-footed, lightly clad Indian glided into the sacristy as if he had slipped from the outlying fog, and almost immediately as quietly glided away again and disappeared. The next moment Father Esteban's gaunt and agitated face appeared at Hurlstone's door. My son, God has been merciful, and cut short your probation. The signal of the ship has just been made. Her boat will be waiting on the beach 2 leagues from here an hour hence. Are you ready? And are you still resolved? I am, said Hurlstone, rising. I have been prepared since you first assented. The old man's lips quivered slightly, and the great brown hand laid upon the table trembled for an instant. With a strong effort he recovered himself, and said hurriedly. Concho's mule is saddled and ready for you at the foot of the garden. You will follow the beach 1 league beyond the Indian's cross. In the boat will await you the trusty messenger of the church. You will say to him, Guadalajara, and give him these letters. One is to the captain. You will require no other introduction. He laid the papers on the table, and, turning to Hurlstone, lifted his tremulous hands in the air. And now, my son, may the grace of God. He faltered and stopped, his uplifted arms falling helplessly on Hurlstone's shoulders. For an instant the young man supported him in his arms, then placed him gently in the chair he had just quitted, and for the first time in their intimacy dropped upon his knee before him. The old man, with a faint smile, placed his hand upon his companion's head. A breathless pause followed, Father Esteban's lips moved silently. Suddenly the young man rose, pressed his lips hurriedly to the father's hand, and passed out into the night. The moon was already suffusing the dropping veil of fog above him with that nebulous, mysterious radiance he had noticed the first night he had approached the mission. When he reached the cross he dismounted, and gathering a few of the sweet-scented blossoms that crept around its base, placed them in his breast. Then, remounting, he continued his way until he came to the spot designated by Concho as a fitting place to leave his tethered mule. This done, he proceeded on foot about a mile further along the hard, wet sand, his eyes fixed on the narrow strip of water and shore before him that was yet uninvaded by the fog on either side. The misty, nebulous light, the strange silence, broken only by the occasional low hurried whisper of some spent wave that sent its film of spume across his path, or filled his footprints behind him, possessed him with vague presentiments and imaginings. At times he fancied he heard voices at his side, at times indistinct figures loomed through the mist before him. At last what seemed to be his own shadow faintly impinged upon the mist at one side impressed him so strongly that he stopped, the apparition stopped too. Continuing a few hundred paces further, he stopped again, but this time the ghostly figure passed on, and convinced him that it was no shadow, but someone actually following him. With an angry challenge he advanced towards it. It quickly retreated inland, and was lost. Irritated and suspicious he turned back towards the water, and was amazed to see before him, not 20 yards away, the object of his quest, a boat, with two men in it, kept in position by the occasional lazy dip of an oar. In the pursuit of his mysterious shadow he had evidently overlooked it. As his own figure emerged from the fog, the boat pulled towards him. The priest's password was upon his lips, when he perceived that the two men were common foreign sailors. The messenger of the church was evidently not there. Could it have been he who had haunted him? He paused irresolutely. "Is there none other coming?" he asked. The two men looked at each other. One said, "Quien sabe," and shrugged his shoulders. Hurlstone without further hesitation leaped aboard. The same dull wall of vapor at times thickening to an almost impenetrable barrier, and again half suffocating him in its soft embrace which he had breasted on the night he swam ashore, carried back his thoughts to that time, now so remote and unreal. And when, after a few moments' silent rowing, the boat approached a black hulk that seemed to have started forward out of the gloom to meet them, his vague recollection began to take a more definite form. As he climbed up the companion ladder and boarded the vessel, an inexplicable memory came over him. A petty officer on the gangway advanced silently and ushered him, half dazed and bewildered, into the cabin. He glanced hurriedly around, the door of a stateroom opened, and disclosed the indomitable and affable Seigneur Perkins. A slight expression of surprise, however, crossed the features of the liberator of Kinkinambo as he advanced with outstretched hand. "This is really a surprise, my dear fellow. I had no idea that you were in this affair. But I am delighted to welcome you once more to the Excelsior." Chapter 7. The Return of the Excelsior. Amazed and disconcerted, Hurlstone, nevertheless, retained his presence of mind. "There must be some mistake," he said coolly, "I am certainly not the person you seem to be expecting." "Were you not sent here by Winslow?" demanded Perkins. "No. The person you are looking for is probably one I saw on the shore. He no doubt became alarmed at my approach, and has allowed me quite unwittingly to take his place in the boat." Perkins examined Hurlstone keenly for a moment, stepped to the door, gave a brief order, and returned. "Then, if you did not intend the honor of this visit for me," he resumed, with a smile, "may I ask, my dear fellow, whom you expected to meet, and on what ship? There are not so many at Todos Santos, if my memory serves me right, as to create confusion." "I must decline to answer that question," said Hurlstone curtly. The Seigneur smiled, with an accession of his old gentleness. "My dear young friend," he said, "have you forgotten that on a far more important occasion to you, I showed no desire to pry into your secret?" Hurlstone made a movement of deprecation. "Nor have I any such desire now. But for the sake of our coming to an understanding as friends, let me answer the question for you. You are here, my dear fellow, as a messenger from the mission of Todos Santos to the Ecclesiastical Commission from Guadalajara, whose ship touches here every 3 years. It is now due. You have mistaken this vessel for theirs." Hurlstone remained silent. "It is no secret," continued Seigneur Perkins blandly, "nor shall I pretend to conceal my purpose here, which is on the invitation of certain distressed patriots of Todos Santos, to assist them in their deliverance from the effete tyranny of the church and its government. I have been fortunate enough to anticipate the arrival of your vessel, as you were fortunate enough to anticipate the arrival of my messenger. I am doubly fortunate, as it gives me the pleasure of your company this evening, and necessitates no further trouble than the return of the boat for the other gentleman which has already gone. Doubtless you may know him. I must warn you again, Señor Perkins, said Hurlstone sternly, that I have no connection with any political party, nor have I any sympathy with your purpose against the constituted authorities. I am willing to believe that you have no political affinities at all, my dear Mr. Hurlstone, returned Perkins, with unruffled composure, and, consequently, we will not argue as to what is the constituted authority of Todos Santos. Perhaps tomorrow it may be on board this ship, and I may still have the pleasure of making you at home here. Until then, said Hurlstone dryly, at least you will allow me to repair my error by returning to the shore. For the moment I hardly think it would be wise, replied Perkins gently. Allowing that you escaped the vigilance of my friends on the shore, whose suspicions you have aroused, and who might do you some injury, you would feel it your duty to inform those who sent you of the presence of my ship, and thus precipitate a collision between my friends and yours, which would be promotive of ill feeling, and perhaps bloodshed. You know my peaceful disposition, Mr. Hurlstone, you can hardly expect me to countenance an act of folly that would be in violation of it. In other words, having decoyed me here on board your ship, you intend to detain me, said Hurlstone insultingly. Decoy, said Perkins, in gentle deprecation, decoy is hardly the word I expected from a gentleman who has been so unfortunate as to take, unsolicited and of his own free will, another person's place in a boat. But, he continued, assuming an easy argumentative attitude, let us look at it from your viewpoint. Let us imagine that your ship had anticipated mine, and that my messenger had unwittingly gone on board of her. What do you think they would have done to him? They would have hung him at the yardarm, as he deserved, said Hurlstone unflinchingly. You are wrong, said Perkins gently. They would have given him the alternative of betraying his trust, and confessing everything which he would probably have accepted. Pardon me, this is no insinuation against you, he interrupted, but I regret to say that my experience with the effete Latin races of this continent has not inspired me with confidence in their loyalty to trust. Let me give you an instance, he continued, smiling. The ship you are expecting is supposed to be an inviolable secret of the church, but it is known to me, to my friends ashore, and even to you, my poor friend, a heretic. More than that, I am told that the Commandante, the Padre, and Alcalde are actually arranging to deport some of the American women by this vessel, which has been hitherto sacred to the emissaries of the Church alone. But you probably know this, it is doubtless part of your errand. I only mention it to convince you that I have certainly no need either to know your secrets, to hang you from the yardarm if you refuse to give them up, or to hold you as hostage for my messenger, who, as I have shown you, can take care of himself. I shall not ask you for that secret dispatch you undoubtedly carry next your heart, because I don't want it. You are at liberty to keep it until you can deliver it, or drop it out of that porthole into the sea as you choose. But I hear the boat returning, continued Perkins, rising gently from his seat as the sound of oars came faintly alongside, and no doubt with Winslow's messenger. I am sorry you won't let me bring you together. I dare say he knows all about you, and it really need not alter your opinions. One moment, said Hurlstone, stunned, yet incredulous of Perkins' revelations. You said that both the Commandante and Alcalde had arranged to send away certain ladies, are you not mistaken? I think not, said Perkins quietly, looking over a pile of papers on the table before him. Yes, here it is, he continued, reading from a memorandum, Don Ramon Ramirez arranged with Pepe for the secret carrying off of Dona Barbara Brimmer. Why, that was 6 weeks ago, and here we have the Commandante suborning one Marcia, a dragoon, to abduct Mrs. Markham, by Jove, my old friend, and Dona Leonor our beauty, was she not? Yes, here it is, in black and white. Read it, if you like, and pardon me for one moment, while I receive this unlucky messenger. Left to himself, Hurlstone barely glanced at the memorandum, which seemed to be the rough minutes of some society. He believed Perkins, but was it possible that the padre could be ignorant of the designs of his fellow counselors? And if he were not, if he had long before been in complicity with them for the removal of Eleanor, might he not also have duped him, Hurlstone, and sent him on this mission as a mere blind, and more infamously perhaps even thus decoyed him on board the wrong ship? No, it was impossible. His honest blood quickly flew to his cheek at that momentary disloyal suspicion. Nevertheless, the seigneur's bland revelations filled him with vague uneasiness. She was safe with her brother now, but what if he and the other Americans were engaged in this ridiculous conspiracy, this pothouse rebellion that Father Esteban had spoken of, and which he had always treated with such contempt? It seemed strange that Perkins had said nothing of the arrival of the relieving party from the Gulf, and its probable effect on the malcontents. Did he know it? Or was the news now being brought by this messenger whom he, Hurlstone, had supplanted? If so, when and how had Perkins received the intelligence that brought him to Todos Santos? The young man could scarcely repress a bitter smile as he remembered the accepted idea of Todos Santos' inviolability, that inaccessible port that had within 6 weeks secretly summoned Perkins to its assistance. And it was there he believed himself secure. What security had he at all? Might not this strange, unimpassioned, omniscient man already know his secret as he had known the others? The interview of Perkins with the messenger in the next cabin was a long one, and apparently a stormy one on the part of the newcomer. Hurlstone could hear his excited foreign voice, shrill with the small vehemence of a shallow character, but there was no change in the slow, measured tones of the seigneur. He listlessly began to turn over the papers on the table. Presently he paused. He had taken up a sheet of paper on which Seigneur Perkins had evidently been essaying some composition in verse. It seemed to have been of a lugubrious character. The titular line at the top of the page, Dirge, had been crossed out for the substituted In Memoriam. He read carelessly. O Muse unmet but not unwept. I seek thy sacred haunt in vain. Too late, alas. The tryst is kept. We may not meet again. I sought thee midst the orange bloom. To find that thou hadst grasped the palm of martyr, and the silent tomb had hid thee in its calm. By fever racked, thou languishest on Nicaragua's. Hurlstone threw the paper aside. Although he had not forgotten the seigneur's reputation for sentimental extravagance, and on another occasion might have laughed at it, there was something so monstrous in this hysterical, morbid composition of the man who was even then contemplating bloodshed and crime, that he was disgusted. Like most sentimental egotists, Hurlstone was exceedingly intolerant of that quality in others, and he turned for relief to his own thoughts of Eleanor Keene and his own unfortunate passion. He could not have written poetry at such a moment. But the cabin door opened, and Seigneur Perkins appeared. Whatever might have been the excited condition of his unknown visitor, the seigneur's round, clean-shaven face was smiling and undisturbed by emotion. As his eye fell on the page of manuscript Hurlstone had just cast down, a slight shadow crossed his beneficent expanse of forehead, and deepened in his soft dark eyes, but the next moment it was chased away by his quick recurring smile. Even thus transient and superficial was his feeling, thought Hurlstone. I have some news for you, said Perkins affably, which may alter your decision about returning. My friends ashore, he continued, judging from the ingenuous specimen which has just visited me, are more remarkable for their temporary zeal and spasmodic devotion than for prudent reserve or lasting discretion. They have submitted a list to me of those whom they consider dangerous to Mexican liberty, and whom they are desirous of hanging. I regret to say that the list is illogical, and the request inopportune. Our friend Mr. Banks is put down as an ally of the government and an objectionable business rival of that eminent patriot and well-known drover, Señor Martinez, who just called upon me. Mr. Crosby's humor is considered subversive of a proper respect for all patriotism, but I cannot understand why they have added your name as especially dangerous. Hurlstone made a gesture of contempt. I suppose they pay me the respect of considering me a friend of the old priest.
So be it.
I hope they will let the responsibility fall on me alone.
The padre is already proscribed as one of the council, said Señor Perkins quietly.
Do you mean to say, said Hurlstone impetuously, that you will permit a hair of that innocent old man's head to be harmed by those wretches?
You are generous but hasty, my friend, said Señor Perkins, in gentle deprecation.
Allow me to put your question in another way. Ask me if I intend to perpetuate the Catholic Church in Todos Santos by adding another martyr to its role, and I will tell you no.
I need not say that I am equally opposed to any proceedings against Banks, Crosby, and yourself, for diplomatic reasons, apart from the kindly memories of our old associations on this ship. I have therefore been obliged to return to the excellent Martinez his little list, with the remark that I should hold him personally responsible if any of you are molested.
There is, however, no danger.
Messrs. Banks and Crosby are with the other Americans, whom we have guaranteed to protect, at the mission, in the care of your friend the Padre.
You are surprised.
Equally so was the Padre.
Had you delayed your departure an hour you would have met them, and I should have been debarred the pleasure of your company.
By tomorrow, continued Perkins, placing the tips of his fingers together reflectively, the government of Todos Santos will have changed hands, and without bloodshed.
You look incredulous.
My dear young friend, it has been a part of my professional pride to show the world that these revolutions can be accomplished as peacefully as our own changes of administration. But for a few infelicitous accidents, this would have been the case of the late liberation of Kinkinambo. The only risk run is to myself the leader, and that is as it should be. But all this personal explanation is, doubtless, uninteresting to you, my young friend.
I meant only to say that, if you prefer not to remain here, you can accompany me when I leave the ship at 9 o'clock with a small reconnoitering party, and I will give you safe escort back to your friends at the mission.
This amicable proposition produced a sudden revulsion of feeling in Hurlstone. To return to those people from whom he was fleeing, in what was scarcely yet a serious emergency, was not to be thought of.
Yet, where could he go?
How could he be near enough to assist her without again openly casting his lot among them?
And would they not consider his return an act of cowardice?
He could not restrain a gesture of irritation as he rose impatiently to his feet.
You are agitated, my dear fellow.
It is not unworthy of your youth, but, believe me, it is unnecessary, said Perkins, in his most soothing manner.
Sit down.
You have an hour yet to make your decision.
If you prefer to remain, you will accompany the ship to Todos Santos and join me.
I don't comprehend you, interrupted Hurlstone suspiciously.
I forgot, said Perkins, with a bland smile, that you are unaware of our plan of campaign.
After communicating with the insurgents, I land here with a small force to assist them. I do this to anticipate any action and prevent the interference of the Mexican coaster, now due, which always touches here through ignorance of the channel leading to the Bay of Todos Santos and the Presidio. I then send the Excelsior, that does know the channel, to Todos Santos, to appear before the Presidio, take the enemy in flank, and cooperate with us. The arrival of the Excelsior there is the last move of this little game, if I may so call it. It is checkmate to the king, the clerical government of Todos Santos.
A little impressed, in spite of himself, with the calm forethought and masterful security of the Señor, Hurlstone thanked him with a greater show of respect than he had hitherto evinced.
The Señor looked gratified, but unfortunately placed that respect the next moment in peril.
You were possibly glancing over these verses, he said, with a hesitating and almost awkward diffidence, indicating the manuscript Hurlstone had just thrown aside.
It is merely the first rough draft of a little tribute I had begun to a charming friend.
I sometimes, he interpolated, with an apologetic smile, trifle with the muse.
Perhaps I ought not to use the word trifle in connection with a composition of a threnodyle and dirge-like character, he continued deprecatingly. certainly not in the presence of a gentleman as accomplished and educated as yourself, to whom recreation of this kind is undoubtedly familiar. My occupations have been, unfortunately, of a nature not favorable to the indulgence of verse. As a college man yourself, my dear sir, you will probably forgive the lucubrations of an old graduate of William and Mary's, who has forgotten his Ars Poetica. The verses you have possibly glanced at are crude, I am aware, and perhaps show the difficulty of expressing at once the dictates of the heart and the brain. They refer to a dear friend now at peace. You have perhaps, in happier and more careless hours, heard me speak of Mrs. Euphemia M. Corkle, of Illinois. Hurlstone remembered indistinctly to have heard, even in his reserved exclusiveness on the Excelsior, the current badinage of the passengers concerning Senor Perkins' extravagant adulation of this unknown poetess. As a part of the staple monotonous humor of the voyage, it had only disgusted him. With a feeling that he was unconsciously sharing the burlesque relief of the passengers, he said, with a polite attempt at interest, "Then the lady is no more." "If that term can be applied to one whose work is immortal," corrected Senor Perkins gently. All that was finite of this gifted woman was lately forwarded by Adams Express Company from San Juan, to receive sepulture among her kindred at Keokuk, Iowa. "Did she say she was from that place?" asked Hurlstone, with half-automatic interest. "The consul says she gave that request to the priest." "Then you were not with her when she died," said Hurlstone absently. "I was never with her, neither then nor before," returned Senor Perkins gravely. Seeing Hurlstone's momentary surprise, he went on, "The late Mrs. M. Corkle and I never met; we were personally unknown to each other. You may have observed the epithet unmet in the first line of the first stanza. You will then understand that the privation of actual contact with this magnetic soul would naturally impart more difficulty into elegiac expression." "Then you never really saw the lady you admire," said Hurlstone vacantly. "Never." "The story is a romantic one," said Perkins, with a smile that was half complacent and yet half embarrassed. "May I tell it to you?" "Thanks. Some 3 years ago I contributed some verses to the columns of a Western paper edited by a friend of mine. The subject chosen was my favorite one, The Liberation of Mankind, in which I may possibly have expressed myself with some poetic fervor on a theme so dear to my heart. I may remark without vanity, that it received high encomiums. Perhaps at some more opportune moment you may be induced to cast your eyes over a copy I still retain, but no praise touched me as deeply as a tribute in verse in another journal from a gifted unknown, who signed herself Euphemia. The subject of the poem, which was dedicated to myself, was on the liberation of women from I may say certain domestic shackles, treated perhaps vaguely, but with grace and vigor. I replied a week later in a larger poem, recording more fully my theories and aspirations regarding a struggling Central American Confederacy, addressed to Euphemia. She rejoined with equal elaboration and detail, referring to a more definite form of tyranny in the relations of marriage, and alluding with some feeling to ungenial experiences of her own. An instinct of natural delicacy, veiled under the hyperbole of want of space, prevented my editorial friend from encouraging the repetition of this charming interchange of thought and feeling. But I procured the fair stranger's address, we began a correspondence, at once imaginative and sympathetic in expression, if not always poetical in form. I was called to South America by the Macedonian cry of Kinkinambo. I still corresponded with her. When I returned to Kinkinambo, I received letters from her, dated from San Francisco. I feel that my words could only fail, my dear Hurlstone, to convey to you the strength and support I derived from those impassioned breathings of aid and sympathy at that time. Enough for me to confess that it was mainly due to the deep womanly interest that she took in the fortunes of the passengers of the Excelsior that I gave the Mexican authorities early notice of their whereabouts. But, pardon me, he stopped hesitatingly, with a slight flush, as he noticed the utterly inattentive face and attitude of Hurlstone. "I am boring you. I am forgetting that this is only important to myself," he added, with a sigh. I only intended to ask your advice in regard to the disposition of certain manuscripts and effects of hers, which are unconnected with our acquaintance. I thought, perhaps, I might entrust them to your delicacy and consideration. They are here, if you choose to look them over, and here is also what I believe to be a daguerreotype of the lady herself, but in which I fail to recognize her soul and genius. He laid a bundle of letters and a morocco case on the table with a carelessness that was intended to hide a slight shade of disappointment in his face and rose. I beg your pardon, said Hurlstone, in confused and remorseful apology, but I frankly confess that my thoughts were preoccupied. Pray forgive me. If you will leave these papers with me, I promise to devote myself to them another time. As you please, said the seigneur, with a slight return of his old affability. But don't bore yourself now. Let us go on deck. He passed out of the cabin as Hurlstone glanced, half mechanically, at the package before him. Suddenly his cheek reddened, he stopped, looked hurriedly at the retreating form of Perkins, and picked up a manuscript from the packet. It was in his wife's handwriting. A sudden idea flashed across his mind, and seemed to illuminate the obscure monotony of the story he had just heard. He turned hurriedly to the morocco case, and opened it with trembling fingers. It was a daguerreotype, faded and silvered, but the features were those of his wife.